Well, I imagine that sometime everyone here has had a day when everything goes wrong. Well, I had one of those days when I worked here at Holden Village back in 1983. It was so crazy I wrote it down, and this is the story of that day. It's called, I Only Wanted to Take a Little Vacation, and Never in My Life Have I Experienced Such Misery. It seems sometimes that misfortune seethes beneath the crust of a normal day, waiting to erupt. It was the brightest of days that morning of January 10th, 1983. The day was sunny, as were my expectations for the little vacation I was about to take to the vastness of the outside world from my mountain home of Holden Village, Chelan, Washington, 98816. It had snowed and rained for several days prior to this sunny one, but now it seemed all too perfect for travel that morning. Six companions and I boarded a snow track at 10 a.m. for the half-hour ride to the Lake Chelan Ferry, which would take us out of the mountains. The Bombardier snow track hummed powerfully and ate up the first 6 miles of the 12-mile drive, when suddenly in our path was an ominous avalanche blocking the road. It was huge, but brave souls that we were, we attacked it forthwith, shovel in hand, and promptly leveled a trail over it for our transport. Surely our troubles were over. We loaded ourselves into the Bombardier, confident once again in our ultimate success, when what did our incredulous eyes perceive in our path but another avalanche, so huge it seemed insurmountable. No doubt these slides were triggered by the heavy snows and rain from the past 2 days. It looked hopeless that we would make the ferry, but being a mechanic, I elected to run 3 miles to get our D6 bulldozer, which sat at the top of the switchback grade, where the road goes downhill to the ferry dock. If I got back in time with the caterpillar, I could easily doze a road through this obstacle and we would catch our boat. Since I was slightly overweight, running through slush in 3-pound hiking boots was not a joyous thing for me to do. At least I did not see an avalanche, and all the way from my comrades to the caterpillar, and hope that my trip still glimmered dimly in my soul. I reached the caterpillar and began to set things in motion. True to its name, the starting engine on the caterpillar started, and the main engine roared to life. I hopped aboard like a knight on his steed to the rescue. Surely a hero was never born who struggled with mechanical failure. I raised my blade high and prepared for a headlong charge back to my stranded companions. No sooner had this thought set my gears in motion than the lift on my dozer blade lost heart and fell to earth. I felt my heart sink slightly also as I tried again. With power to spare, up went the blade, and with heart to want, again it fell to earth. It must be the clutch on the cable winch, thought I, as I rigged up some badly battered tools from the toolbox to make repairs. Sure enough, the blade lift soon had power and heart to spare, but now instead of falling down, it was constantly flying up. Back to the tools and clutch I went, and after much fine-tuning, had it going up and down of its own will. Although lamentable at best, I felt at least now it might mediate itself. With this thought in mind, I headed the beast back down the road with the blade flapping like a flag. Perhaps in response to my earnest hope, the blade ceased its pointless flapping and relinquished itself to my control. But then another calamity. There in the road where I had been only half an hour before was the most mammoth avalanche I had yet encountered. It loomed about 25 feet high and 30 yards across. With great fortitude, I lowered my stabilized blade and began the attack. It soon became apparent that at my present rate of progress, we would be lucky to make the January 13th ferry. My friends and the bombardier had surmounted the previously insurmountable avalanche, but like myself, were left speechless at the base of this last massive slide. With time running short, we contrived one more desperate plan. It was decided that another driver and I would plow the road open to the switchbacks and drive back to the avalanche in our suburban station wagon. Since the switchback grade section of the road was still open, it was possible we could drive with reckless abandon from the avalanche to the lake and still catch the ferry. Plow we did and reached the suburban at the top of the switchbacks in record time. Unfortunately, the road was barely passable, and I determined I should also plow back to the stranded bombardier with our snow plow, which also sat at the top of the switchbacks, along with another small bus. I put the plow in six-wheel drive, started it up, and lowered the plow. With Tom Witt close behind, we headed back. Whoomp! I hit the first snow pile and coughed. The engine died. I tried again, but all those six wheels could push and the whining engine could pull was not enough to move this slushy snow. Once again, the old bulldozer was the only hope. I fired it up and prepared to rattle again down that beaten path. No sooner had I set my tracks in motion then once again the blade on my rebellious caterpillar began its relentless flapping. Once again I brought forth my battered tools for more fine-tuning, while Tom decided it was best to brave the road without me. Several adjustments later, performance was restored to the blade lift, and I was hot on Tom's heels. I got back to the avalanche just as the Suburban was heading out. I shut down the dozer and jumped in one of the wagon's open doors on the run for the final leg of our perilous journey to the now waiting ferry. The recently plowed road was bad at best, but Tom held a generally true though winding course. When we reached the top of the open road at the switchbacks, I felt the odds were finally beaten and smiled a warm inward smile of success. Oh no. What was that odd flapping sound where there used to be the hum of our left rear tire? It just couldn't be. A flat tire while driving on snow? My mind was staggered but not overcome, as I was certain it could be changed in time. Soon the tire tools and the spare were retrieved. We could have changed the tire and still made it to the ferry if only the jack had not been broken. I sat in the snow and hung my head in defeat. Word was received by radio that five of us, which did not include